Good morning, everyone. The topic for today is iron deficiency anemia, right? The contents that we'll be talking about today is, we'll be talking about briefly about anemia, the symptoms, iron deficiency anemia, which is basically abbreviated as IDA, right? We'll be talking about iron and oral and parenteral iron preparation. Okay. Anemia, it basically comes from the Greek word called anhyma, which is basically without blood. So it is a deficiency of red blood cells or hemoglobin. We call it a hematologic condition in which there is quantitative deficiency of circulating hemoglobin, and it is often accompanied by reduced number of erythrocytes. Right? It is usually associated with decreased hemoglobin or hematocrit. Abnormal hemoglobin may give the appearance of anemia as well in case of methemoglobinemia. It may be classified as moderate if the hemoglobin level ranges from 7 to 10 gram per deciliter, or it may be classified as severe anemia if the hemoglobin level is less than 7 gram per deciliter. Anemia basically decreases the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood, and this is as a result of diminished erythrocyte mass. Two general forms of anemia, they are absolute anemia or relative anemia. And absolute anemia is due to decrease in red cell mass, which is the actual anemia, and relative anemia is increased plasma volume that gives the appearance of anemia. Relative anemia may be seen in pregnancy when the plasma volume increases, and this gives just an appearance of anemia as well. Anemia in general can be due to erythrocyte loss as a result of bleeding. It can be due to decreased erythrocyte production, which may be due to low erythropoietin or decreased bone marrow response to erythropoietin, increased erythropoietin destruction, erythrocyte destruction due to hemolysis can also lead to anemia. Anemia is known to affect almost a third of the world's population, and half of the cases are due to iron deficiency. And it is considered as a global public health problem because it affects maternal and child mortality. Again, there is it affects the physical performance as well, and it is one of the most important reasons that leads to referral to healthcare professionals. Like, the people who are basically affected by anemia are children who are like 0 to 5 years of age, because their need of iron is relatively higher in the growing age, right? And women of childbearing age and pregnant women particularly are at risk. Several chronic diseases are frequently associated with iron deficiency anemia, like chronic kidney disease, chronic heart failure, cancer, inflammatory bowel disease, etc. Okay, now let us have a look at the considerations by the age, sex, and other factors, like newborns. When the newborns are less than 1 week old, their hemoglobin level is between 14 to 22 gram per deciliter, and as they grow old, their hemoglobin level starts decreasing. By 6 months of age, the hemoglobin level is 11 to 14 gram per deciliter, and by between 1 to 15 years, it's between 11 to 15 gram per deciliter. The normal hemoglobin level, it depends upon gender, right? And it's 12 to 16 gram per deciliter in female and 14 to 18 gram per deciliter in males. But once it reaches the geriatric population or postmenopausal phase, like even the male and female, they come to the same range between 12 to 16 gram per deciliter. We just said the factors that affect, right, hemoglobin level, like age was discussed earlier and sex was discussed, but then there are also other factors, like other factors that cause changes in the hemoglobin level, like environment, the elevation of the plains versus the mountains. Like in case of mountains, because there is already deficiency of oxygen or lesser amount of oxygen, they have got more RBCs in them, right? Physical health, the lung or kidney disease, which may decrease the amount of RBCs. Again, nutritional deficiencies, blood loss, bone marrow replacement, and chemicals or radiation, which can all lead to anemia. Okay, have a look at this chart, which shows the symptoms of anemia. Basically, all the symptoms are pointed out here, and those which are pointed in red are seen only in case of severe anemia. Yellowing of the eyes, right, with the scleral region, and yellowing of the nail beds is the typical sign that is seen in case of anemia, right? And the skin paleness is there, coldness, yellowing is there. In respiratory, there is shortness of breath, muscular weakness. And when it comes to CNS, the dizziness, fatigue, fainting can all be seen, right? Low blood pressure is there. Similarly, palpitations, rapid heart rate, chest pain, angina, heart attack can all be precipitated as a result of angina, and spleen enlargement can be there. Okay, so symptoms can of anemia can be divided as two ways, like one due to decreased oxygenation and second due to decreased volume itself, right? As a result of decreased oxygenation, there are following symptoms like exertional dyspnea, dyspnea at rest, fatigue, bounding impulses, lethargy, and confusion. And decreased volume like fatigue, muscle cramps, postural dizziness, and syncope. However, there are special considerations in determining anemia, like in case of acute bleed. What happens is that following an acute bleed, if you look at the hemoglobin level or the hematocrit level, then there will not be a drop because you are just analyzing the specimen right after acute bleed, right? Even though the patient is hypertensive, you don't see those changes. Similarly, in case of third trimester of pregnancy, the RBC and plasma volume is expanded by 25 and 50% respectively, and labs will generally show a reduction in hemoglobin, hematocrit, and RBC count. And they show like anemic levels, but according to RBC mass, they are actually polycythemic. And volume depletion, persons who are severely volume depleted may not show anemia unless until they are rehydrated. Because of volume depletion, it will see as if the RBC number is quite high or the hemoglobin is quite high. But only after you rehydrate the person, then you see actual case of anemia. Okay, now these are the main causes of anemia. If you look at it, right, there is hemolysis, acute bleeding, chronic disease, iron deficiency, and others. Okay, so today what we're interested in is iron deficiency. So iron deficiency anemia, in shortly we call it IDA. It is the most common form of anemia worldwide, right? In men and postmenopausal women, the commonest cause of IDA is blood loss from the lesions in gastrointestinal tract, and it is a common cause for referral to gastroenterologist. Okay, when we say blood loss in the gastrointestinal tract, it might happen as a result of peptic ulcer or duodenal ulcer mostly, right? But then there are other various reasons as well that cause blood loss in the GI tract. And another reason that might lead to IDA is also iron malabsorption. So iron deficiency anemia, in case of iron deficiency anemia, what happens is that the body needs iron to produce hemoglobin, that is necessary for RBC production, right? And in general, people mostly need just 1 milligram of iron daily, because the iron that we have in our body is generally recirculated again and again, right? Even we said that iron is present mostly in heme, right, or hemoglobin. And 66% of iron that is present in our body stores is present in hemoglobin. And that hemoglobin, though RBCs have a life cycle of 120 days, right? So after 120 days, when the RBC breaks down, the hemoglobin is again broken down, and then the same iron is recirculated again. So there is loss of 1 milligram daily. So it is that the 1 milligram that we need from external sources. Menstruating women generally need the double the dose. Like if it is 1 milligram for normal people, the menstruating woman would need 2 milligram during those days. Let us look at the successive stages of iron deficiency. First, there is iron deficient erythropoiesis or functional iron deficiency. And this might lead to depletion of iron stores, because our body has got iron stores which will normally compensate for the inadequate iron that is taken for some reason, but for some period of time it can come from the iron stores. But if the iron stores eventually got again depleted, then iron deficiency anemia is seen. So the etiology of iron deficiency anemia is increased demand for iron or hematopoiesis. Increased demand is in the case of children and pregnant women, right? Iron loss as a result of different things. Basically, bleeding is one of the main reasons for iron loss, right? And decreased iron intake or absorption. Iron loss can happen in physiologic condition as a result of menstruation. In pathological conditions, like as a result of surgery or delivery postpartum hemorrhage, hemoglobinuria, hemoptysis can also be another reason. Similarly, gastrointestinal tract pathology, like we said, we talked about peptic ulcer, duodenal ulcer, right? And in case of blood donation as well. Okay, have a look at this chart. It indicates the different causes of iron deficiency. The first is increased iron loss as a result of gastrointestinal, right? Second is increased iron loss, non-gastrointestinal. The third is increased malabsorption and increased demand for iron. The last being inadequate diet or intake. Vegetarians and vegans, they are known to have some kind of iron deficiency as well, right? When it comes to increased iron loss, we see that peptic ulcer has come in the topmost, right? Topmost reason. So peptic ulcer is one of the most important thing, and in our part of the world, parasitic infections like hookworm infestation is another important part. Apart from that, cancer, inflammatory bowel disease, gastritis, they all are known to cause increased iron loss. Similarly, increased iron loss non-gastrointestinal is may occur due to menorrhagia, recurrent epistasis or recurrent nose bleeding, right? Urinary blood loss, but then they are relatively lesser. And iron malabsorption can occur in celiac disease, previous gastrectomy, and acralhydria or hypergastrinemia. Acralhydria is a state where there is decreased secretion of HCl or almost non-existent HCl, very low levels. Increased demand of iron, we just said earlier, is there in case of pregnancy or adolescent and in kids, right? Similarly, in case of erythropoietin therapy, when you are giving erythropoietin therapy for increasing the red blood cells, then you also need to give more iron. There is increased demand of the iron. When there is anemia, then there is serious elderly patients as a result of chronic anemia. And this can worsen the condition of underlying cardiovascular disease like tachycardia, increased cardiac output, vasodilatation can be there. So in absence of adequate iron, the small erythrocytes with insufficient hemoglobin are formed, and this gives rise to the microcytic, the small size ones, and hypochromic as a result of less hemoglobin in them, right? So microcytic hypochromic anemia is seen. So iron deficiency anemia is a kind of microcytic hypochromic anemia. Clinical manifestations we discussed earlier as well, right? Fatigue is there, decreased exercise tolerance is there, tachycardia, dermatologic manifestations, decreased intellectual performance, dysphagia, depression, and restless leg syndrome is also there. Okay, now coming on to the pharmacology part now, right? Now we'll be dealing with the management of IDA. The treatment of IDA basically consists of replenishing the underlying etiology, correcting the underlying etiology as to what caused anemia in the first place, and replenishing the iron stores. Just trying to add iron without correcting the underlying etiology may not be of use, right? So we should correct the underlying etiology as to what is causing the problem, and then replenish the iron stores. And because ferrous iron is most efficiently absorbed, the ferrous salts should be given. And when it comes to ferrous salts that are used in iron deficiency anemia can be ferrous sulfate, ferrous gluconate, ferrous fumarate. And ferrous sulfate itself can be on anhydrous one or hydrated one. Okay, we'll be talking about them in detail later on. They are all effective and inexpensive. They are recommended for the treatment of most patients. Ferrous sulfate is the most commonly used form. There is better absorption and lower morbidity. And toxicity is generally proportional to the amount of iron that is available for absorption. It is said that about 25% of the iron gets absorbed from when given orally. Generally, parenteral iron should be reserved for patients who are either unable to absorb oral iron or have increasing anemia despite adequate doses of oral iron. And sometimes transfusion of RBCs is also required, but then it should be reserved for patients who are experiencing significant acute bleeding and they are in danger of hypoxia or coronary insufficiency. Okay, have a look at this chart. If you've already done the absorption of iron in biochemistry and physiology, then you must understand this chart pretty well, this picture, right? This picture is taken from CADSEM pharmacology. Go through the picture. And then we'll be talking about it. Okay, what you say is that when you give iron orally, then the iron that is given, most of the iron that is given is, we said that our drugs, they are basically in ferrous form, right? The iron preparations, they are basically in ferrous form, but other sources, the iron that we get from other sources, they are basically in oxidized form in ferric state. So if the iron is in ferric state, then it first needs to get reduced to the ferrous form, and then the ferrous forms gets absorbed as a result through the divalent metal transporter DMT1. This helps in active absorption of iron, and the heme iron gets absorbed through heme carrier protein 1. They both help absorb the iron into the cells. Now, what happens to the absorbed iron is that it can either get transported into the blood through the action of ferroportin out here, FP, right? This ferroportin, it helps absorption of the iron, or the passes of the iron into the blood. If the remaining amount of iron that is not passed into the blood, what happens is that they conjugate with apoferritin to form ferritin out here, and then ferritin gets lost out here, or ferritin stores is formed, right? For the iron that gets transported into the blood, what happens is that it binds to transferrin out here. You see that the transferrin, and then transferrin has bound to the iron, right? The iron that is bound to the transferrin then gets either to the bone marrow precursor cells, bone marrow erythrocyte precursor cells, for the formation of hemoglobin, or it can get transported to the hepatocyte. If it gets transported to the hepatocyte, then it can again form the stories. It can go. It can form ferritin and get stored as ferritin for uptake in both bone marrow erythrocyte precursor cells and hepatocyte. There is transferrin receptors which help bind to the transferrin bound iron, right? And then it helps internalize the iron. And once the iron is internalized, this receptor discloses the transferrin bound iron, and this receptor comes to the plasma membrane again to get other iron molecules. And the same happens in both the places, right? And here, the same step of binding with apoferritin to form ferritin is there. Similarly, at the end, in spleen and other macrophages, what they do is they basically help recycle the hemoglobin that is present in the senescent RBCs or the senile RBCs, right? They engulf the RBCs that are senile after 120 days, and then the hemoglobin part is broken down. From hemoglobin, the iron that is found, that is broken down, is transported back to the blood, or it is stored as ferritin. Okay, this is the same thing that was explained in the picture earlier, right? So let us move to the next slide. Okay, now coming on to iron. We said earlier that the adult male requires 0.5 to 1 mg. 1 mg was the thing that we said earlier, right? Our normal requirement is around 1 mg. And for adult female who is menstruating, the requirement is around 2 mg. For infants, they require around 60 microgram per kg. Children, similarly, 25 microgram per kg. And pregnancy, the last two trimesters, one requires 80 microgram per kg. This is for the fetal growth, right? Infants, here you see that the requirement is around 60 microgram, and adult female, you see the requirement is around 20 microgram per kg. So they both add up, and then in the last two trimesters, the pregnant female would require around 80 microgram per kg. So there are different dietary sources of iron as well, right? The ones which are generally rich in iron is liver, egg yolk, oysters, dry beans, dry fruits, wheat germ, yeast. They are all rich in iron. Similarly, meat, chicken, fish, spinach, banana, apple, they are medium sources. And milk is relatively poor product, but then we take it on a daily basis, right? So it's there. We normally take lots of dietary sources of iron. we normally therefore do not require iron supplement, whereas the menstruating female, iron is given to them along with OCPs. When OCPs are given, or oral contraceptive pills are given, what is done is they are basically given for 21 days OCPs, and 7 days they are given placebo pill, which generally contains iron to help with, to help give, replenish the iron stores. And in case of pregnancy, you don't start iron ahead in the first trimester, because in that, in the first trimester the need is pretty low, right? And in the last two trimesters the need is high, so iron supplement is given. Here it shows the total body iron content in the adult, right? It's 2.5 to 5 gram, and on average it's 3.5 gram. In men, it's around 50 mg per kg, and in women, it's around 38 mg per kg. It is distributed in hemoglobin 66%, ferritin and hemosiderin iron stores as 25%, myoglobin in muscles 3%, and parenchymal iron in enzymes like 6%. And iron forms nucleus in iron porphyrin heme ring, which you've done in biochemistry, right? In absence of adequate iron, small erythrocytes, which are insufficient, with insufficient hemoglobin are formed, and this is how microcytic hypochromic anemia is seen. Okay, now let us look at the factors that help facilitate the iron absorption. Acid helps by favoring the dissolution or reduction of ferric iron, thereby it favors the iron absorption. Therefore, when you give iron preparations, you normally add vitamin C or ascorbic acid to the regimen so that it helps the absorption of iron. Similarly, reducing substances like ascorbic acid, as we just mentioned. Similarly, amino acids that contain the acid radical like cysteine and methionine, they are helpful. The agents help in reducing the ferric iron and form absorbable complexes as well. Meat also helps by increasing the HCl secretion and providing the heme iron. We just said that acid help in absorption of iron. So alkali is basically renders the iron insoluble and opposes reduction. Therefore, it impedes the absorption. Similarly, phosphates that are rich in egg yolk, they also decrease the absorption of iron. Similarly, chelates, tetracyclines, and other foods, when they are present in the stomach, they impede the absorption of iron. In general, the bioavailability of iron-formed cereal-based diet is relatively low. The bioavailability of the iron-based drugs, ferrous salt, ferrous drugs, is around 25%. Okay, now uses. The only clinical use of iron preparation is the treatment or prevention of iron deficiency anemia. It is available in both oral and parenteral preparations, we said earlier, right? For GI, if GI absorption of iron is normal, then oral and parenteral agents, they are both equipotent. We can either use oral or parenteral, but because oral is much easier, we go for oral as the first choice, and parenteral, they are preferred only in case of chronic kidney disease, if patients are undergoing hemodialysis, if they are going to treatment with erythropoietin, if they are unable to absorb oral iron, if they are unable to tolerate oral iron, then we go for parenteral iron. Okay, so oral iron therapy, they can be in different forms. Have a look at this picture. All the different forms of iron that is generally given orally is discussed out here, ferrosulfate, right? And ferrosulfate, it can be given in hydrated form or dried form. Hydrated form, it has got 20% of iron in it. Dried form, 32% of iron, right? Similarly, ferrous gluconate has got 12% of iron, elemental iron in it. Ferrous fumarate has got 33% of elemental iron. Ferrous succinate, 35% of elemental iron. Ferrous citrate, it is now used for CKD or chronic kidney disease, right? It is not used in dialysis so far. With oral iron therapy, what generally happens is that the tolerance to iron can be relatively low in some people. There can be severe gastrointestinal effects, adverse effects like nausea and vomiting. So if a person develops serious gastrointestinal effects to one form of iron, then changing to another form of iron may be helpful. Okay, this is taken from Katsang again, right? You can see that there are different forms of drug, right? The tablet size is given, and the elemental iron that is present per tablet is given. Elemental iron we said earlier as well, right? In case of ferrous sulfate hydroxide, it is 20%. So when you give 325 mg, 20% of this is only present as elemental iron, because along with iron there is sulfate molecule as well, and there is water molecule as well. So elemental iron denotes the amount of pure iron or iron only that is present in this ferric tablet. Okay. The usual adult dose is given in when treating iron deficiency, like 2 to 4 tablets are taken per day. Okay. So what you can see is that in different forms of iron, right, there's different iron size, and they all give different levels of iron. Like ferrous sulfate, both hydrated and desiccated, they give elemental iron 65 mg, but the tablet size is 325 and 200 mg, because this contains 20% of iron and this contains 32% of iron. Okay. Okay, now moving on to in an iron deficient individual, what happens is that around 50 to 100 mg of iron can be incorporated into hemoglobin on a daily basis. But since 25% of iron that is given as ferrous salt can be absorbed, you need to give around 20 to 400 mg of elemental iron in order to correct the deficiency very rapidly. But some people, they are unable to tolerate high doses, so lower doses of iron may be necessary. So you might need to give the drug for a relatively longer time, but nevertheless, it will heal slowly, but then it will still complete the correction of iron deficiency. The treatment with oral iron should be continued for 3 to 6 months after correction of the cause of the iron loss, because that will help to correct anemia and also to replenish the iron stores in the future, for the future. The adverse effects are basically dose-related: nausea, vomiting, epigastric discomfort, abdominal cramps, bloating, colic. They are all seen. Constipation and diarrhea, they both can be seen. Right, staining of teeth, metallic taste, they both are relatively common. These adverse effects can be minimized by dose reduction or by taking it immediately with meals or after meals. And when taking iron preparations, black stools are relatively common. So normally the patient should be advised not to think of it as blood stools. However, the prescriber should be vigilant that the iron that is given cannot be also be obscuring the GI blood loss. Typically, if the patient is suffering from peptic ulcer or other kind of GI bleeding. Okay, now moving on to parenteral iron therapy. Parenteral iron therapy should be reserved for patients with documented iron deficiency, like who are unable to tolerate or absorb oral iron, patients who have excessive chronic blood loss, and patients who cannot be maintained on oral iron alone, and patients who are non-compliant to oral iron. Patient can be non-compliant because of the various adverse effects that are associated with it, right? Compliance is when patients do not take the medicine exactly as directed by the physician. We call them non-compliant, and because of various adverse effects, GI adverse effects, people can stop taking it. Various other reasons when parenteral therapy is needed is different post-gastrectomy conditions, previous small bowel resection, IBD involving the proximal small bowel, malabsorption syndromes, advanced chronic renal disease including hemodialysis, and treatment with erythropoietin. Okay, now coming on to what is the challenge with parenteral iron therapy is that in case of parenteral iron therapy, you cannot give simple inorganic free ferric iron because it produces dose dependent toxicity. Right? So what should be done is that ferric iron should be formulated as a colloid. And what kind of colloid are we talking about? It is a core of iron oxyhydroxide should be surrounded by a core of carbohydrate, and this should release the bioactive iron slowly from the stable colloid particles. So iron dextran is one of such examples, right? It is a stable complex of ferric oxyhydroxide and dextran polymers. It contains 50 mg of elemental iron per milliliter of solution. It can be given by deep intramuscular injection or by intravenous infusion, but then intravenous route is commonly used because intravenous route is non-irritating. It doesn't irritate, right? Deep intramuscular injection route, it causes irritation and then can cause muscle problem, pain in the muscle. And intravenous route, because it is less painful, it allows delivery of entire dose of iron that is necessary to correct the deficiency in one go. Other forms of iron that are used in parenteral iron therapy as iron sucrose complex and iron gluconate complex. In case of iron dextran, we said that it can be given IV or IM, right? But in case of iron sucrose and iron gluconate complex, we give them as IV only. And when we are giving IV, there is less hypersensitivity reactions with iron sucrose and iron gluconate complex. The adverse effects out here is nausea and vomiting, headache, lightheadedness, fever, arthralgias, back pain, right? And flushing, urticaria, bronchospasm, and rarely it can also lead to anaphylaxis and even death. And some are attributed to the hypersensitivity reactions of the dextran. That's why we said iron sucrose and iron is relatively less hypersensitive, right? So test dose should be given when we are using iron dextran complex. The adverse effects can also be divided as local and systemic, in which local there is pain at site of IM injection, pigmentation of the skin and sterile abscess. In systemic, there is fever, headache, joint pain, flushing, palpitation, chest pain, dyspnea, and lymph node enlargement. For patients, when they are treated chronically with parenteral iron, it is very much important to monitor the iron storage level so as to avoid toxicity of iron overload. Because when we saw the picture earlier about the iron absorption, transport, and its utilization, when we give iron orally, the absorption is sort of regulated. But then when we are giving iron by parenteral route, there is no regulatory mechanism in between. So serum concentrations of ferritin and transferrin saturation, this should be conducted on a regular basis. Poisonings have been seen in infants and children when they take relatively large dose of iron, right? Like as much as 10 tablets of iron, if it is consumed by its children, then it can be poisonous to the children. Okay. So poisoning can be manifested as vomiting, abdominal pain, hematemesis, diarrhea, dehydration, acidosis, lethargy, cyanosis, convulsions, finally shock and cardiovascular collapse, and even death can result. Its antidote is desferrioxamine or deferrioxamine as well, we call it. It is a chelating agent that is used against iron and aluminium. Okay, so acute iron toxicity is linked with poisoning, and poisoning can be in the form of acute iron toxicity as well as chronic iron toxicity. Acute iron toxicity is seen with young children who accidentally take iron tablets like chocolates, right? So they feel as if it is a chocolate and then they take it, and 10 iron tablets can be even lethal to children. The symptoms include necrotizing gastroenteritis, vomiting, abdominal pain, lethargy, dyspnea, severe metabolic alkalosis, coma, and even death. Whole bowel irrigation and deferrioxamine should be initiated and with supportive therapy for GI bleeding and metabolic acidosis and shock. Okay, with chronic iron toxicity, iron overload can happen or hemochromatomasis can occur, right? So excess iron gets deposited into various organs like heart, liver, pancreas, and causing organ failure and death. So this is basically seen in case of inherited hemochromatomasis, which is a disorder of excessive iron absorption. In absence of anemia, this is treated by intermittent phlebotomy or removing 1 unit of blood every week until the excess iron is removed. And parenteral deferrioxamine is much less absent, so oral form of deferrioxamine is used, which is convenient as well. Blood transfusion in the treatment of anemia is not so common, right? It is recommended only in pregnant women if the hemoglobin level goes less than 6 g/dL because of abnormal fetal oxygen concentration. If the transfusion is performed, then 2 units of packed red blood cells to be given, and clinical situations to be reassessed to guide the further treatment. Okay, that was all about iron deficiency anemia.